Welcome to the Atmosphere Church channel. On behalf of all of us here at Atmosphere, thank you for watching. We pray that this message will touch your heart and change your life. Regardless of what you believe, where you come from, or what questions you might have, you are welcome here. Our desire is to help lead you in experiencing God by following Jesus. If you want to find out more information about us, head over to our website at atmosphere.church. And don't forget to click below to subscribe. Enjoy the message.
Mr. Grinch, you really are a heel. You're as cuddly as a cactus, you're as charming as an eel, Mr. Grinch. You're a bad banana with a greasy black peel. You're a monster, Mr. Grinch. Your heart's an empty hole. Your brain is full of spiders. You have garlic in your soul, Mr. Grinch. I wouldn't touch you with a 39 and a half foot pole. Christmas.
Well, good morning, everybody. Merry Christmas to you. Yeah, how's everyone doing? It's nice and cozy in here versus last week. It was a little bit chilly out there, but we are glad to be just gathering. That's what we're pumped about. So, hey, how many of you would say Grinch is your favorite Christmas movie? I didn't hear that last week from anybody. A couple of you guys. So, yeah, welcome. My name is Pastor Jim, by the way, and I'm the lead pastor here, and it's great to have you. And as you can see from that little clip, we are in a series called Christmas at the Movies. I noticed some of you grabbed some popcorn on your way in, and you're like, I thought this is church. I'm not ready for a movie, but you need to know something about the Bible and specifically about Jesus. He loved to give big kingdom ideas through story. They called them parables back in the Bible. And so it's a story with a message. And think about what movies are. Movies are modern day parables like Jesus told. And we all love our Christmas movies. Some of you have been watching them since August. All right, that's a different sermon. But we're just looking at some of the favorites out there. And today we are going to be looking at how the Grinch stole Christmas. So we're full throttle in the Christmas mode. I love the bands. Go Tell It on the Mountain. Good job, Kenzie and the team. That was amazing. But hey, Christmas to me means more than just December 25th. It's always a time that I celebrate my anniversary. We got married on 12/12/92. And so today is Tara and I's 29th anniversary. She's rocking a mermaid dress. How many remember those mermaid dresses? And that's me and my young face. We were young. I think I was 21. She was 20. And that's our wedding cake. But the rest of everybody got Costco cakes. It's been such a cool life with my bride. So I just had to say happy anniversary to us before we get into the message. All right. So if you guys have your Bibles, you could grab our app on the App Store. You could download it. We put all of our notes on there so you can follow along. But we are going to be in the Gospel of Matthew today, and we're going to be in chapter 2 specifically. And before we get to that, I know speaking about movies, you know, why do Christmas movies just touch our hearts a little bit extra versus other movies? And you know, I just started thinking about that. They inspire us to believe, right? They just get into us, challenge us to change, spur us on to be more generous. There's something about these Christmas movies. And I was thinking about The Grinch specifically because there's different versions of this. How many grew up watching the cartoon version, right? I just found out, little trivia for you, Chuck Jones, that did all of the Looney Tunes animations, was the one that did the original 1960s version of How the Grinch Stole Christmas. And but my personal favorite, come on, is the 2000 version with Jim Carrey. That was just next level. There were some impersonators that still do it, and I was thinking about bringing them, and Tara's like, don't do that. It will scare the children. Because, I mean, think of, like, for us, it's kind of fun, but for a four-year-old, that guy's really creepy looking. You know, that's enough to give, like, a four-year-old nightmares for a long time to come. So we decided to not bring the impersonator. But I love this idea of the Grinch in, you know, if you've watched the 2000 version of this movie, there's just some things about the Grinch that just is funny, but yet very relating, because everybody knows a Grinch to some degree. Somebody that is not as big of a fan of Christmas as you are. Some people, Christmas is like one of those things that they just kind of dread almost. Like, this is just something that they're not really looking forward to. And this is interesting. Where does the word Grinch come from? And there are some people that believe it is derived from a French word. I should have Pastor Phil pronounce this, but it's Grichot, which means grumpy, which means grumpy. Now, I will tell you that the holidays can sometimes, they give some people some good feels, like everyone's like just kind of like smiling a little bit more. But for some other people, it brings out their grumpiness a little bit more. How many know somebody that at the holiday time, they just get a little bit more grumpy? And I could notice it just driving on the 101. I'm like, it's just like, it's out there. So I thought this was really good. CBS did an article, 5 signs that you might be a Grinch. I thought these are good. And so if the shoe fits, wear it. All right. Number one, you tend to hold grudges. You tend to hold grudges. People who don't let go of a hurt continue to re-experience the frustration, pain, and resentment each time they recall the wrong, whether perceived or real. So you tend to hold grudges. Number two, you use lots of obscenities and abrasive language in your conversations. Of course, not around your pastor. I always love like talking to somebody they don't know. I'm a pastor, and man, they're just cussing, you know, like a sailor. They're just going, and then somebody's like, "Oh, you know, he's my pastor," and then all of a sudden it's like, "Oh," like busted. Like, hey, man, you know, I've heard that language before. But it's like people that are Grinch, like, they have no filters. They just, if it comes to their mind, they just say it, and even though it may be really hurtful or angry. Number three is you are impatient. It doesn't take much to set you off. Somebody might say you are short-fused. And this is the person at the back of the line openly complaining how slow the line is, or the person that is just continuously finishing your sentences before you're even done. You know, it's like, come on, get on with it. Number four, you get irritated easily. Music and other noises tend to annoy you. An enjoyable evening for you would be to have no one around you. Am I feeling any of you this morning? Do we have any Grinches in the house? Number five, you are a chronic complainer. You're known for going on rants about politics or sports, local issues of the day. You especially have a habit of complaining about other people. Anyone score a 5 out of 5? You're like, yeah. It happens. But you're a mean one, Mr. or Miss Grinch. You know, this is kind of the whole personification of the Grinch and how he has this movement of the spirit of Christmas that ultimately changes his heart. But you know, the Grinch wasn't the first one to try to steal Christmas, right? And if you are a fan of Christmas movies, there was the original Christmas movie with Ebenezer Scrooge, which ironically, the cartoon version is Jim Carrey again. But I just think of that, like, that is 1847 Charles Dickens' tale, A Christmas Carol, and this is the original guy that did not like Christmas, that was a grumpy guy, bah humbug. You know, Christmas Eve was just another day to work and make money. But even before this, like, you've got to know that there was an original Christmas canceller, and his name was King Herod. And this is how we tie in the Bible to the whole Grinch movie. But Matthew chapter 2 is where we find this episode. And it's interesting how the Gospel of Matthew kind of lines this out, because this is the text where we learn about the Magi, and a lot of our nativity scenes have, you know, the three wise men, but you just got to know, like, if you want to be really accurate with this, the wise men didn't, you know, visit the baby at the birth. They came sometime later. So if you want to be really biblically accurate, you know, you put your manger scene out at Christmas, but sometime in August, you know, set up a little thing and then put the wise men out in August, and then, you know, you'll be more biblically accurate and the neighborhood will be talking about you, all right? But this is what it says in Matthew chapter 2. It says, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him. And when King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. In Bethlehem in Judea, they replied, for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search carefully for the child. And as soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him. Fingers crossed behind his back, right? After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. I love that. On coming into the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and they worshiped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. So this is the original Christmas canceler, because Herod later went on and pretty much created a genocide with all of the toddlers 2 years old and below. Killed them. And I just think, you know, what a horrific thing to do. But Herod was threatened by Jesus, especially how the Magi kind of presented him as this next king of the whole entire world. And Herod was an insecure leader. And so he didn't want his leadership, his kingdom, threatened by this new up-and-comer. So better take the baby out before the baby becomes a man and ultimately can take his throne. But the Magi, think about this. I want us just to focus on this for a second. They come, and most Bible scholars believe they were from this area of Persia. And a little geeky biblical history is that most Bible scholars believe they were from this remnant of Magi that were put together by Daniel, the great man of God, Daniel, in the Old Testament. And they believe that in this whole transition of Daniel being with these guys, that he deposited in them this great big idea of a Savior that would come to Bethlehem. And this is how they knew it. And they followed the star. They went with them. And then they brought gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Now, we could really look at the symbolism behind that. But I believe, honestly, as they brought these gifts to this young couple that were instant parents, teenagers. A lot of people believe that Mary was the original 16 and pregnant. They believe that she was very, very young. And so a young couple needed some sources of income. So think about the gold, frankincense, and myrrh. They're great gifts, but they're also good supplemental income so that they can have the funds to be able to raise a young family. So gold, a lot of people believe, is a symbol of the royalty and the kingship that Jesus would have. The frankincense was a resin from a tree burned to a small for its small smell rather during temple worship. And frankincense represents Jesus being worshipped as God of myrrh. This is an oil used to anoint the dead before burial. Myrrh representing Jesus' humanity and death. But I look at this whole story in the Gospel of Matthew and how it's painting this picture of Herod being threatened and the Magi coming and really setting up Joseph and Mary to be able to raise Jesus. And it's so good. And tying it back to the movie, there's two big overarching themes of how the Grinch stole Christmas. One is the commercialization of Christmas, right? The consumerism. The problem of consumerism and Christmas, especially in our culture. And the other one is the poor condition of our hearts. That the Grinch had an issue with having a heart two sizes too small. Remember that part and the whole book, the original book that came out. So what I want to do is I want to jump into these themes and tie it back to this passage that we find in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 2. And here's the first point that we can learn from this big kingdom truth that we can unpack from this crazy movie, How the Grinch Stole Christmas. Number one, and that is reset your focus. Reset your focus. And we all need to hear this because we are at probably the pinnacle of the Christmas season, where I believe we're already being charged extra if you want to receive your gifts on Amazon before Christmas. You have to pay a little bit extra fee. How many discover that? You're like, wow, I'm already too late for this whole season, man. It's the middle of December, and we have to have all of our gifts bought and everything put up. And this is what we need to do. We need to pull back. We need to just step back. And we need to make sure that we don't let the festivities that we are all kind of a part of in experiencing crowd out Christ in Christmas. Now, I'm not being like a Grinch or a Ebenezer Scrooge and bah humbug. If you celebrate Christmas, you're not a Christian. You know, I'm not on that camp. But I do believe there is a moment in this whole festivities, especially as we're ramping up, that we do need to take a step back. And we need to analyze exactly how we are approaching Christmas as a person, not just a person of faith, but as a follower of Jesus. Like, this is the time that we get to celebrate the coming of the King. Like they did in the original story, the Magi coming. Like, this is a time that we can ultimately honor Jesus for not just coming as a baby, but actually coming as a baby and growing into a man that would become a sacrifice for our sins and would ultimately reconnect us back to God. And it's good for us to remember all of this as we're celebrating this, because I tell you, there's some Grinch in me that comes out when there's so much stuff that is going on, and my life is already busy, and then put on top of that, parties to go to, gifts to buy, and have you ever just, you know, paused, like, in your sending out your little Christmas cards? You know, I know that people don't do this as much as they did, like, 15 years ago, but did you guys ever send out, like, a little letter to update your family about your family, you know, hey, this is what, you know, Joey has done all year, and pictures, and then Tara and I got into this whole thing, and then it's like, well, you better send it to so-and-so, because if they get a card and they don't get a card, they're going to get offended, and so, like, and pretty soon, like, it was like a Pandora's box, like, if you send it to this person, then that person needs it, and then pretty soon, we're, like, sending 5,000 cards to people that we barely know, and I just said, time out, man. This is crazy. And this is where I celebrate social media, because you don't have to send anything out. You just post it. And if people want to look at it, they can look at it. If not, no big deal. We save 50 cents every postcard. But I mean, that there's that, and then there's holiday baking, and these are all good things. Holiday baking and baking stuff and buying gifts, that's all good. But we can get so into this that we forget the worship of our King. I found this to be interesting, that according to the data provided by the National Retail Federation, this is short for the NRF, Americans plan to spend roughly $998 per person on gifts, food, and decorations in 2021. Now, I say that figure, and some of you are like, oh my goodness. Others of you are like, that's it? Like, gosh, that's crazy low. But I just started thinking about this. I don't want to, like, shame you and like buying gifts, because I think it's fun. It's a great way that we can practice generosity towards other people. But there's these things that are good that can become bad. Are you tracking with me? The good things can become bad things, like on a dime, if we're not careful and if we don't take a step back and realize the overarching thing. And now you can go buy this on, you know, the wall at Hobby Lobby, and you see this in Christmas mugs. And this isn't just some kind of catchphrase. This is really what we need to focus on and what we need to talk about this morning, and that is Jesus is the reason for the season. He is not a reason. He is the reason. Jesus removed, you have no Christmas. And so Herod tried to stop Christmas. He couldn't do it. Jesus came. So we need to really kind of pull ourselves together, really kind of look at this and say, how am I celebrating Christmas where I can reflect that truth, that Jesus is the reason for the season? You could do that and still go to parties and still buy gifts and still send out your, you know, 5,000 cards to all of your friends and acquaintances. You could do all that. But the moment that you start moving into the space where Jesus is getting buried in all the stuff, then you know you've kind of you've lost focus, I should say, of the idea of what Christmas is supposed to be all about. The Magi brought gifts, not to each other. They brought it to honor the king. They brought it to honor the king. They brought it as a supplemental income for this young couple so that Jesus could actually have food on the table and he could be raised and he could be healthy and become the man that would ultimately take away the sins of the world. So here's just the practical side of this, and hopefully maybe this will inspire you. But how can we take this moment of resetting our focus and be able to take Christmas and really put the focus back on Christ? And these are just some ideas. You don't have to do these. These are things that my family and I, we've instituted within our families, and it could be helpful for your family. But these are just ideas. You don't have to do them, all right? But here's the first one. Maybe Christmas morning you start a new tradition. And we've done this, and many families that I've talked to, I actually was inspired by another person that gave me this suggestion, is that every Christmas morning before the gifts are opened, we read Luke chapter 2 together. And we just kind of reflect on the meaning of why we're here and why we're even celebrating and doing these gifts. I think that's really cool. Just to be able to pause and remember Christ before we get into all of the craziness of what's happening. And just to be able to slow down in all of the hubbub of Christmas Eve and Christmas, I think it's good. Here's another suggestion. As a family, think about perhaps spending less so that you could give more. Think about spending less so that you can give more. Now, I'm not over here saying, like, I think if you buy gifts for each other, you're not very spiritual. Like, no. But think about, okay, just going back to that average, okay, $1,000 per person in America. So there are 332 million Americans in our nation, okay? So I just did the math really quickly. So if we just maybe still spent half of that. Let's say we're spending 500 instead of 1,000. We're just cutting back. We're spending less so that we could give more. I did the math right on my iPhone. If you take $500 that you spent less on and you move that towards actually doing something for the kingdom as maybe supplementing some income for the kingdom, that is $166 billion. What could we do for this world, for God's kingdom, with $166 billion? Now, I'm just thinking more microscopically at our school in Zambia, where they have to pay for their education. And so we partner with Pastor Ernest and his wife, Laika, and they take the kids up to eighth grade. Their vision is to eventually have a boarding school that we've kind of talked with them about over the years and how they could take the kids all the way into a place where they could then go to college. But to sponsor one of their students through secondary school, which would be equivalent to our high school, it would cost about $500. So you could take $500 and help a child in Zambia, Africa, get their education. Because one of the biggest reasons why poverty is cyclical is a lack of education. Isn't it crazy? Here we have education for free. There it costs money. But we, as Americans, have come over there and helped raise these kids up. And so every year, we take a little bit of our money that we collect at the end of the year, and we send it to Pastor Ernest so he could take his students that are going into secondary school and sponsor them to the next grade to where eventually they could graduate, maybe even go to college. We have been able to help Pastor Ernest launch students into the medical field. Two of their former students came back as certified teachers, and so now they're giving back to the same school that gave to them. And that's just cool. And I'm just using that as an example. There's so many ways that we could leverage some of the money that we're putting towards Christmas and actually make a big difference for the kingdom of God. You know, I hate to sound like a broken record, but for us, like, not having a building in COVID has created some major complications. And so we're searching desperately for a building, and God is leading us
But we want to be prepared for that. And so what if like that spending less so that you could give more could help us leverage a position to where in 2022, we believe God is going to give us a place that we could meet, we could gather, we could do concerts, we could have worship nights, we could have recovery groups. I mean, we could use that building every day of the week, a place for young people to come and gather. I mean, right now we're peppered. They're meeting at a hotel somewhere. We got youth meeting in our backyard when it's 40 degrees outside. This is crazy. We're making it work. But your little bit, combined with everybody else's little bit, we could make a big difference. We could actually have a place that we could call home on a more permanent basis. But again, this is just another example. 2 weeks ago, I went over to our Vegas church, which I was the former pastor of, and I saw what they were still doing. They're feeding people in the heart of the city of Las Vegas every Saturday through a food pantry ministry. And because where our church is located, we are in like the really rough part of Vegas. It's the best way I could describe it. One of the first Sundays that we opened that campus, there were two people out in the parking lot. One guy pulled a gun on the other guy. And a friend of mine was like, "Jim, I just stopped a gunfight in your parking lot." He goes, "What? Where are you at?" I go, "I know, bro. It's next level." But we're giving out about 4 tons of food from the back of that church every Saturday. I was like, wouldn't that be cool? Because I still feel like they're family for me personally. Wouldn't it be cool if like we took a little bit of our income, of us spending less so that we could give more and maybe bless our sister church campus in Vegas and say, we want to give so that you guys can continue to give to the community around you. I think that'd be cool. But I mean, we have idea after idea after idea. The bottom line is, how can we take what we are being given by God and turn it around at Christmas time and be more generous to give to God and to his kingdom? I just think this is a part of this idea that we're getting into about resetting our focus. Now, another idea, and this could be something that you could do. So we could, you know, again, you could just pause on Christmas morning and say, we're going to reflect on what this means. You can, you know, spend less so that you could give more. And here's another thing is maybe you can buy a gift and wrap it all up. And I mean, just Christmas morning. This is for those of you that want to do something next level. And I've done this many, many Christmas mornings, and it's fun. But you go as a family, go in the car and go on a reverse treasure hunt. You know, treasure hunt is you're going to go out and look for treasure. And a reverse treasure hunt, you're going around so that you can find somebody to give treasure to. And so what we would do is we would go to like Walmart or Target and, you know, buy a blanket, buy a jacket or whatever, wrap it up, and then drive around. And some person walking around Christmas morning, just walking around, maybe you drive down into the valley. Maybe you go over here to some other poor areas where somebody's walking around Christmas. Number one, why is that person walking around Christmas? Around here, they may just be exercising, all right? But in other neighborhoods, it's truth, right? In other neighborhoods, they may just be alone. They may not have anybody for Christmas. But number two, they may not have anybody giving them a gift. And your blanket, your jacket, whatever, your candle, whatever, it may not be a big deal. It may not cost you a lot of money. But you can make a big difference by just letting somebody be seen and loved on Christmas morning. Wouldn't that be cool? And I'm just kind of throwing these ideas out to you. You don't have to do them, but I've done them, and it's been so much fun. Okay, so that's the first one. Here's the second thing that we could take away from How the Grinch Stole Christmas, and that is recondition your heart. So we're resetting your focus, and the second thing is we're reconditioning your heart. And some of us, our hearts need a major overhaul. And the question that happens a lot, you know, as I've kind of like lived, you know, 50 years on this planet, is why do people have to be so mean? Have you ever just met a grumpy person and just thought like, what? How did they get so grumpy? How do they get so mean? How do they become so cynical and all of this stuff? And here's what I learned, and you may have not figured this out yet, so I want to give it to you so that you can have more of an empathetic heart towards mean people, and that is hurt people hurt people. Hurt people hurt people. There's stuff lodged in them that has gone undealt with maybe for decades, and they have no channel of healing because they are not following Christ, and Christ is the one who doesn't just recondition our hearts. Christ gives us a new heart. Come on, somebody. He takes the old heart, and he doesn't just heal it up. He says, I got a brand new one for you. In Ezekiel 36, verse 26, he says, and I will give you a new heart. This is the prophet Ezekiel looking ahead at the promised Messiah. And I will put a new spirit in you. I will take out your stony, stubborn heart and give you a tender, responsive heart. Here's what I figured out. And you got to lean into this point. You can change someone's mind, but only God can change someone's heart. I'm going to say that one more time because this is really good. You can change someone's mind, but only God can change someone's heart. You got to let God do what he's going to do in order for that person to become the new kind of person. It starts by God getting a hold of the heart. And there's stuff, as you live this life, stuff gets lodged in there. Sometimes it's self-inflicted. You put yourself in positions that you allow these things to just get lodged there, just get stuck there, and things are just there, and you're carrying this hurt, you're carrying this wound. Other times, you're just a victim of circumstances. You were at the wrong place at the wrong time with the wrong person, and stuff happened. A relationship went south, and things took place that were bad. And what happened in that season is your heart possibly grew too, or was too small. Two sizes too small. I can't do my nursery rhymes. But this is why this is important. For those of you that are already following Jesus, you've already been given a new heart. You can get a new heart from God and still mess up that new heart that God's given you by allowing stuff to take root inside of your heart. This is why I love this proverb. 4:23, guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. Guard your heart above all else. I think back 10 years ago, I was drinking a lot of caffeine. I was drinking like the supersized jumbo frappuccinos. Terrible. 3,000, 4,000 calories. Four shots of espresso. Come on, somebody. And I started having heart issues. Duh. No human's supposed to consume that much caffeine. And so I was having issues and heart palpitations, and I was like passing out, and things were like weird. And so I have a cardiologist friend in Bakersfield, where I was living at the time, and I said, man, I need somebody to just check my heart because something's not right. And so he went in and he did the EKG, and put me on ultrasound, and he just checked out my heart. And really, honestly, that was a breakthrough appointment for me. You know, coming into my 40s, I was like a wake-up call almost, because I've had several friends now that have died of massive heart attacks, and they just were alive, and next thing you know, they're gone. And so it was a really good education for me, a good drill for me to going into my 40s to take better care of my health. But it really came down to three things that he diagnosed me with or kind of gave me a prescription for. He said, number one, Jim, you got to look at your diet. Your diet will make or break your heart. And it's so true, as all of these, you know, studies are continuing to show heart disease is one of the most preventable diseases that medical professionals know about. Like, we can prevent heart disease based almost solely on our diets and what we're consuming. Number two is exercise. Just making sure that you're getting out there and you're working your system and you're getting your cardiovascular system in top tip-top shape, and you're moving, you're doing stuff, you're walking, or you're running, or you're getting on that Peloton bike, or whatever, you know, thing that you're doing, and that's good. And then here's the third thing, just monitoring things and going in, getting your physical every year, getting your blood pressure done on a regular basis, having EKGs performed just so that you can monitor any kind of things that may not be showing up right, that are showing that there may be a problem so that you could go in and get some special attention. Now, thinking about this idea of your physical heart, there's not much difference of how you care for your physical heart that you do your spiritual heart, that innermost part of who you are. It really comes down to the same three things: diet, exercise, and monitoring. If you really want to guard your heart and even get to this place where you can see a reconditioning of your heart, if you just look at these three things, I'm telling you, this is going to be breakthrough for your life. Some of you don't have to walk around getting stuff lodged in your heart every day. God doesn't want you living like this. And so he's put these things in place so that we can really take care of the heart that he's given us. And what kind of diet? What are we talking about when we're talking about our spiritual heart and our diet? Think about the things that we consume spiritually that are kind of moving against ultimately God allowing us to live in his peace. It's something that we got to kind of wake up to, that there is stuff in our culture that if we just let it have its way in our lives, in our families, it's going to mess our lives up. And I could give you a laundry list of things. I don't even need to, because you already know those things. Because something inside of you, when you're watching something, listening to something, or around certain environments, you're just like, have you ever just paused and said, this isn't good for my soul? To be here, to do this, you're just kind of like, this isn't good. This is the part where the Spirit of God gets on the inside of you and starts convicting you, because he's like that warning light on the dashboard. Like, if you continue to go down this road, something is going to get lodged in your heart, and it's going to make it very difficult for you to have a heart that grows three sizes larger, just like the Grinch. I told you I'd turn it back over there, all right? Matthew 5:8, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. You know, we could get super legalistic right now on this point.
This is, don't do this, stay away from that.
I could just like spit all over you guys and give you like, don't. But this is Jesus, and he's keeping it so simple. He said, if you really want to see God in your life, if you want to hear from heaven in everything that you're going through for your life, then just simply pause and be more diligent to keep your heart pure. Now, for some of you, this is equivalent to going out to your garage or your basement or your attic, and you're just like, there's a lot of stuff in here, man. And it needs a good cleaning. Are you feeling me right now? It needs a good cleaning. You need to go take some stuff out of that space, because when you clear out some space, you make more room for God. When you, and some of you, you don't want to look in those old, you know, Rubbermaid boxes. You're just like, it's painful, and I feel you on that. It is painful, but it's necessary, because God wants you to experience him. He wants you living in this place where you don't just see God show up on Sunday mornings. And I love it that you get to come here and God shows up and he encourages your heart. What we're talking about is not a Sunday experience. We're talking about a lifestyle where God is showing up in your everyday, ordinary lives, where you're waking up on Monday and he's showing up, And he's doing things, and he's speaking some things, and he's guiding you in ways. And so what you need to do is you just need to take a step back. What things that I need to get rid of? What guardrails do I need to put up? And say, this isn't healthy for my heart. This is your diet. And I believe God, even as I'm speaking this, even though I'm not giving you a laundry list of all the don'ts, The Holy Spirit is right now in this moment giving you a don't. And just understand this. Anytime you read in the Bible where God says don't, he's really saying don't hurt yourself. I want to reframe how you're looking at some of these things that Scripture tells us to avoid. God is not a killjoy wanting to rob us of having fun in this life. He wants us to maximize our life. And there are things that we allow into our life that actually keep us from experiencing the fullness of life that he wants to bring to our life. So right now, whatever that is that God is whispering in your heart right now to say, that needs to go. Listen to it. Step into that. In the exercise part, this is the fun part where you get to take the stuff that we're talking about on Sundays and you apply it to your life. You exercise your faith. And as you're exercising these things and you're practicing confession, you're practicing devotion, you're actually getting to a place where you're sharing your faith with coworkers and you're talking to them about the goodness of God and how God has changed your life. You're listening to the nudge and you're praying with that lady at Target, or you're going to the grocery store and you know, in the produce aisle, you're saying, hey, I got a scripture that I can't shake that you're supposed to have. And you're like, that's radical. And I'm telling you, it is, but it's the best kind of way to live. And if you exercise your faith like this, you're only going one direction, and you're going to grow, and you're going to grow, and you're going to grow, and that faith is going to rise, and it's going to rise, and it's going to rise, and you're going to be an unstoppable force for the kingdom of God. Your heart is going to be in a right place. And here's the last point, and that is the outside monitoring. How do we have, like, the doctor exams and the blood pressure and the EKG spiritually speaking? Well, to me, it's pretty simple. This is what the gathering is all about. Is you have me and Pastor Phil a part of your life that we're no doctors by any means, but we want to be your spiritual coach so that we can help walk you through some things. And if there's issues in your life, we want to be available for you. But it goes beyond just like the pastors. This goes to just your life groups and the people that you're circling up with that know you and know the all of the kind of moving parts that you're dealing with, and have relational equity that if you're kind of going off, if you're veering off path, they can say, bro, like, I sense that you're not in a good headspace. Yeah, dude, I'm not. This is why when you get into a circle, you could fool the pastor because I only get to see a lot of you once a week, but you can't fool your life group. You can't, dude. They know you. They know your stuff. So they're your outside monitoring system. Yeah, this could be family. This could be counselors. And in all seriousness, I want to speak to some of you. You got some deep wounds in your heart, whether it's self-inflicted or circumstance created. I want to just tell you, it's okay to get counseling. And sometimes it is not just okay, it's probably a requirement for you to really get past some stuff. Yeah, I'm really excited about what God is doing through our recovery ministry that he's created, and Kathy and Lisa answered the call and created Life's Healing Choices for Women. And I'm pretty pumped that I got Blair and some other people here from Celebrate Recovery that beginning of the year, we're going to have something to offer the men too. And it's going to be cool. But sitting in a circle and just going through some of these deep wounds, these hurts, these habits, and these hang-ups that have been preventing you from stepping into the fullness of God, that we're going to have a group where you're going to be able to circle up with, and you're going to be able to be honest with, and without feeling condemned or without feeling judged, you're going to be able to go get the proper help. But that's the outside monitoring. If you do the diet, if you do the exercise, you do the outside monitoring, your heart is going to grow. And you might even start leaking. Can I tell you something about tears that I've learned? And I've read some science articles on this, but I really believe it. Sometimes when I'm preaching, I'll make eye contact with people, and I can see your tears. And do you know, every time I see a tear, I rejoice. Because to me, tears represent healing. They even did a study one time to look at the teardrop itself, and I don't know how valid this is or not, but if you look under a microscope at tears, there are these like cross-like little images that will pop up in the tear. So I just think when the tears start flowing, I believe God is moving in your heart, and he's healing some wounds, he's healing some hurts, and he's dislodging some stuff. He's reconditioning that heart so that you could be the person that he's called you to be. And I believe there's some healing that he wants to do today. I believe there's breakthrough that he wants to bring us today. And so if you're able to, would you just stand with me? And everyone, just let's stand together. We're going to worship. And as we're worshiping on the song, my prayer for you is that whatever God is speaking to you in this moment, maybe it's just like, man, I got to reset the focus. I've got to recondition my heart. I want to pray for that healing to take place in you today. Father, as we are just entering into a time of responding to what you have been speaking, may your Holy Spirit do a deep work in all of our hearts. Lord, I know that today there's some major stuff lodged inside many people in this room. And only you can change our hearts. So, Lord, we invite you into this moment to heal us. For some of us, to give us a brand new heart. As maybe some of us say yes to following you for the very first time in our lives. And while everyone is praying and meditating on maybe what the Spirit of God is speaking to you personally, some of you are far from God today. Maybe this is the first time you've ever entered into a place like this. And you can feel the presence of God so thick in this moment. And I want to tell you, that feeling that you're feeling right now on the outside of you wants to come and live on the inside of you. And how that happens is you make a decision today to say yes to following Jesus. And that prophetic word that Ezekiel got in Ezekiel 36 is going to be true for you today. That he's not just taking your broken heart and repairing it. He's actually coming in to replace it, to give you a new heart. Some of you have never said yes to following Jesus. And if you want to enter into this relationship with God and let his presence get on the inside of you, it really, honestly, it starts with a decision that you make. And we do it at our church through just having you pray a simple prayer. And this is where your journey with God begins. This is where you make a decision to say yes to following Jesus. And so if you're ready to pray that prayer, you're ready to say yes to following him, I invite you right now in the space as I pray, just pray after me. You don't have to pray it loud. Maybe just pray it even in your heart. But I'm going to pray, and you could just agree with me afterwards. Say, Jesus, today I understand that I am in desperate need of a new heart for my life. And I say yes to everything that you have for my life. I say yes to making you king of my life, so that you can lead me and I can follow you, for you will lead me into the ways of everlasting. And as you not just repair my heart, as you replace my heart with a new heart, God, I thank you for giving your life for me so that I can live a life that you've always called me to live. I receive your Spirit inside of me. I receive your presence inside of me. And help me to develop that and to mature so my heart may grow 3 sizes bigger and I may be a person that represents you and is living in the fullness of life that you've given. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. If you prayed that prayer, those connection cards that we handed out on your chairs, that's for you to connect with us so that we can partner with you in this decision that you made. Because we don't want you making this decision by yourself. We're your family. We want to walk with you on this decision. But besides filling out that connection card and putting in these collection boxes, tell somebody today you made a decision to follow Jesus and keep coming back. And it's going to be great. The communion tables are open. Let's worship. Let's honor God. And let's make Jesus the reason for the season.
Thank you for tuning in today to another great message from Atmosphere Church. If this message has spoken to your heart, would you take a moment and share it with your friends? You can connect with us on Spotify, iTunes, Podcast, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Simply do a search for Atmosphere Church through these various platforms and then click the follow or subscribe button. If you're watching this video on YouTube, you should see it right below this video. It's another great way for us to be able to stay connected with you. If you live in the Southern California area, we would love to invite you to be part of our family. For more information about our church, go to our official webpage at atmosphere.church. Finally, if this service and our other resources bless you, would you consider giving back to Atmosphere Church to support not only these things, but also support the creation of even more resources for you? To make a donation, simply go to our website and click on the tab that says Give. Your gift of any amount is greatly appreciated. Until next time, we pray that you will keep the faith, spread the hope, and live the love.